So there's three things I want to talk about tonight, generally, just three things. So if you leave here tonight, I want you just to understand these three simple concepts. One, what is police use of force? What is qualified immunity? And what is summary judgment? A lot of times people will have opinions on things, and everyone's always entitled to their opinions, but I think you should have a basis for your opinion, right? So any presentation, whether I'm teaching in the university or teaching a course for the State Department, anyone, I always say that it's up to you to be informed, and then you can decide whether or not you want to be transformed. So you may have the knowledge, you'll know what's right, what's wrong, but doesn't necessarily mean you will do what's right. So I want you to think about being informed to transform. And if you talk about qualified immunity and summary judgment, or a police officer used too much force, well, have a basis for understanding, you know, to be able to make that that assessment. And I always, because I'm a foodie, I always like to use food as an analogy. If you look there, there's a wedding cake, right? And we don't know what's inside that wedding cake. We don't know if there's strawberries, bananas, we don't know if there's chocolate, we don't know if there's dulce de leche. We don't know what's inside the cake, but we don't have enough time tonight to actually go inside the cake. So the only thing that we're going to do for a couple moments is lick the icing on the outside of the cake, right? We're just gonna lick the icing on the outside of the cake.
It's necessary for me to be as vigorous in condemning the conditions which cause persons to feel that they must engage in riotous activities as it is for me to condemn riots.
I think we've got to see that a riot is the language of the unheard. And what is it that America has failed to hear?
I think America must see riots do not develop out of thin air.
I got a Jones, say a name. I got a Jones, say a name. I got Carl Davis a hand. But it really doesn't matter with me now, because I've been to the mountaintop. Like anybody, I would like to live a long life, longevity has its place. But I'm not concerned about that now. I just want to do God's will. And He has allowed me to go up to the mountain. And I've looked over. And I've seen the promised land. I may not get there with you. But I want you to know tonight that we as a people will get to the promised land.
So I ask you this, so all these names, you know, I guess African tradition is that, you know, people that have transitioned, we speak their name, we say their names, that they're not forgotten. But if I ask you all the names that were put into the ether, what did they all have in common? Okay, they were killed, right? They were killed. And I would say the interesting thing is some of the names that were there, that I should say the misfortune of being asked to review the police officer's actions. Freddie Gray case. I was asked to review those officers' actions, and to determine whether or not the police officers acted reasonably. And I'll talk about what it means to act reasonably. Where we may think one thing, that there's no way they should have engaged in this, they shouldn't have done that. And I tell you, you get the service based on the people that are in positions. The laws are based on people that, you know, that make the laws, people that we vote for. So I was going to base this little talk on two cases. One is Officer Newman Raja, who is a police officer in Palm Beach County, Palm Beach Gardens, Florida. It was a case that I worked on where he shot and killed a gentleman, and I was hired to review the shooting. This other case here, which I won't talk about, I don't know if anybody know the significance of Officer Crespo. I don't know if you have an opportunity tonight, go home and Google Officer Crespo. Officer Crespo is a Newark police officer that shot and killed two individuals. An individual that was in a stolen car that had a gun, passenger in a car had no gun. The State Department, I should say, the Attorney General's office instructed the New Jersey, the Essex County Prosecutor's Office to hire an outside consultant to determine whether or not the charges that they filed against the officer were reasonable or not. So I was the individual. I was asked to review the officer's actions. The officer's actually standing trial. His trial started about a week and a half ago. And the ironic thing, I said I wasn't going to talk about Crespo, right? that's me. Like sometimes when I don't know if it's a spirit or whatever it is, but sometimes someone says, "Just say it," so I cannot not say it. But anyway, the interesting thing with Officer Crespo violated the Newark Police Department's use of force policy. when he shot those two individuals. But Officer Crespo's, when he shot those two individuals, his actions were consistent with what the U.S. Constitution says. So what I will talk about is that New Jersey may have one standard, but the Constitution, right? Everyone has to follow the Constitution. So New Jersey has what we call a more restrictive policy. It says you cannot do this. When I look at a case, I don't look at it based on a specific state standard. I look at what is the federal standard, right? So if there's a curfew, let's say a town has a curfew that says everyone needs to be off the streets by 12 o'clock p.m. So the time everybody has to be off the street is what time? What time? No, the curfew is 12 o'clock p.m. That's the law. So what time does everyone have to be off the streets? But what if your mother says, you need to be home when the streetlights come on? That's more restrictive than what the law says, right? So you can be in compliance with the law, right? Meaning that you can stay up, it's 12 o'clock, but mama said you gotta be home when the streetlights come on. That may be 7 o'clock. So you have to comply with the more restrictive. And that's what New Jersey has. So an officer, I wasn't gonna talk about this other case. What was the name of the town?
Dixon. Was Officer Dixon
involved? Yeah, Officer Dixon. I got hired, and again, when I say Dr. Chapman, I'm like, oh, medical doctor? I'm like, oh, no, not a medical doctor, a PhD and PhD, but I bill your town's insurance companies, right? So every time a police officer or your commissioner or mayor or someone that gets sued and it either goes to federal or state court, majority of the time I get retained on behalf of that town, and I bill their insurance company. New Jersey guys have a JIC, it's like a joint insurance company. Well, part of one of the cases, you know, like when you have patients, your patients come. I had one case, okay, what's his name again, Brian? I can't remember the guy's name.
Officer Dixon.
Officer Dixon. And if you ever looked at newjersey.com, Officer Dixon has the luxury of being the number one police officer in the state of New Jersey that has the most use of force incidents. The most use of force incidents out of everyone. And when I reviewed his case, I'm like, man, there's no way he should have did what he did, right? The last case was like this little small young lady. She maybe weighed 120 pounds. He was a big guy. He was going to arrest her. She didn't want to be handcuffed, so he took his hip and he did a judo throw, threw her on the ground. You can see it. You can go on to NJ.com. You can see he threw her on the ground. Judo, wow, threw her on the ground. She got hurt. She says with excessive force. Yeah, they didn't look good. And people are like, well, how can you defend him? I said, the reason I can defend him is because he did exactly what the New Jersey Attorney General told him to do. They trained police officers to do judo throws, and he did exactly what he was trained to do. Even though we say that's not reasonable, he did exactly what he was trained to do. So if you train a person to do these judo throws, when they go out, you expect them to do what? A judo throw. When they do it, and you're like, well, you shouldn't have did it. Well, that's what you trained that officer to do. So when I evaluated the case, when I wrote my report, I said, yeah, it wasn't reasonable, but reasonable is not the standard. The standard is objectively reasonable. And I'll talk about what that means. He did exactly what he was trained to do. Again, when we say that NAACP is not political, we encourage you to vote. We encourage you to know the positions of the people that you are voting for, to be informed. Because again, the officers do exactly as they're trained the majority of the time. So again, I'm going to talk about police use of force, qualified immunity, and summary judgment. So, just by show of hands, how many people think that a police officer, when they go to arrest someone, should use the minimum amount of force necessary to arrest a person? That they should use, you know, they shouldn't use a lot of force. They should use the minimum amount of force that's necessary. Yes, one?
Yes.
One more time. How many people think that police officers, when they go to arrest someone, should use the minimum amount of force? Right? Like if you don't have to shoot the person, you shouldn't shoot them. If you can just like maybe you just have to tap them a little bit with your stick or spray them with pepper spray, that police officers should be required to use the minimum amount of force necessary to effectuate a lawful arrest. Does everyone agree with that? Yeah, sounds logical, but it's not the law. Police officers are not required to use the minimum amount of force. And that's where the disconnect is. That's the disconnect. We see a police officer do something,
are like, there's no reason that you needed to throw this person on the ground. There's no reason you're supposed to do, you know, you needed to do that. That's not what the law says. The officer only has to use an objectively reasonable amount of force based on the situation. If you want the officers to use the minimal amount of force, well then how do we get the law changed? The legislators. Legislation. Right? And I find, you know, majority of citizens think police officers need to use the minimal amount of force. That was the standard back prior to 1986. That's no longer the standard because the Supreme Court said that it's impossible for an officer to calculate what is the minimal amount of force in every situation. So the officer doesn't have to do that. They only have to use a reasonable amount of force. A reasonable amount of force. What would a reasonable person have done in that same exact situation? And then that gets to Officer Raja. Officer Raja, who shot and killed an individual that had no gun. He did have a gun. Officer Roger's in jail, I'll tell you this. He shouldn't be. And I'll tell you why he's in jail. He's in prison. He should not be. And I'll talk to you about why he's in jail or prison. So again, when I say the minimum amount of force, police officers are not required anywhere in this great nation to use the minimum amount of force. They're only required to use a reasonable amount of force. So when we say, well, why didn't you shoot the person in the arm? Why didn't you shoot the person in the leg? Why didn't you get two people? Why do you need three cops to stop one person? Why do you have the person sitting on the ground? If you don't want those things, you need to vote. You need to know the positions of your legislators, right? So I'll talk about police use of force, qualified immunity, summary judgment. So the position of the NAACP is that we call upon our legislators and the executive branch of government in their respective local, state, and federal jurisdictions to end qualified immunity for law enforcement officers. To end qualified immunity. And let me talk about what qualified immunity is, right? This is the big topic, qualified immunity. Immunity, think about the coronavirus, right? We want to give you something so that you don't catch something. So qualified immunity is that if a government actor, anyone that works for the government, whether it's an FBI agent, whether it's a police officer, whether it's a mayor, council person, if you work for the government and you engage in certain acts, you're immune from any civil liability, meaning that you cannot be sued in your individual capacity. Just today, I don't know how many people saw, there was an article, I think it was NJ.com again, where they were talking about all the municipalities in the state of New Jersey that have paid out money in lawsuits. Millions of dollars. You know, a couple of them are in Union County. You know, they go across the state. The amount of money that municipalities pay out dealing with police and other misconduct. And again, it doesn't mean just because the agency or the town decides they were going to pay, they may say, you know, I do a cost benefit analysis. If this person wants $500,000 or this person wants $100,000 to make this case go away, and it's going to cost us $200,000 in legal fees, what's the thing to do?
Pay it,
right? Yeah, you settle it out. But that's not always the case. There's sometimes when we say, well, you know what? A lot of times, again, GIFs, insurance companies, they'll call me and they'll say, what do you think this case is worth? One of the most recent cases that I worked on, our client got $12 million. Largest settlement police use of force case in the state of New Jersey and in the country. $12 million, but he's a paraplegic. Right. So, police officials, public officials are shielded from lawsuits unless the action violates a clearly established constitutional right. And that's the key thing. So if a police officer does something and they do it wrong, the question is it clearly established that you can't do that? Is it clearly established? Like, does every police officer know that you were not supposed to kick the person in the head? Is that clearly established? And if it's not, then they have qualified immunity. It has to be clearly established, and that's why I get hired a lot, saying, well, what is the standard across the country? Should a police officer have known that they should not have, when the person was handcuffed to a bar, right, they're handcuffed to a bar inside the police department, and the police officer says, as I was walking by him, I feared for my life, So I took out my pepper spray and I sprayed him in the face, and then I punched him and then I kicked him. Is it clearly established that you don't need to use force against someone that's handcuffed to a bar when they can't move? And when I was speaking with the insurance company to determine how much would be reasonable, you know, it's kind of a, it's not a joke, but it was kind of funny. We said, there's only one good thing about this case. There's only one good thing. Police officer has a guy handcuffed to a bar, right, to this bar here, and he's walking by it, and he says, I fear for my life. So he took out a pepper spray, a mace, sprayed the guy, punched him, kicked him, because he was afraid. Is it clearly established? The only good thing was that the person that was chained to the bar was white. Imagine if he was black. You didn't hear about that case, right? Because it was only a white guy. It only gets the attention when it's a minority, right? And that's it. If it's wrong, it's wrong. So, yeah, it could have been. So qualified. Yes.
So in that case, did the police officer get paid odds?
So the city paid, and the police officer still working. Qualified immunity. Police officers do not have to be perfect. They can make mistakes, but it has to be a reasonable mistake. And summary judgment. Summary judgment is like something that a judge made up in the case. And this is what summary judgment simply is. Summary judgment is that you believe that someone violated your rights. Let's talk about it. Police officer used excessive force, too much force against you, and you want to sue them. A judge is going to look at your paperwork and they're going to say, I can decide this case without even having any testimony. I'm just going to look at the paperwork and I'm going to decide whether or not your case should proceed or not, without any evidence. I have an article that I wrote that's in the African Journal of Criminology, and every time I go into a court, I should say the article came out last year, and every time I go into a court, quite often the judge will always say, nice article, because the title of the article is, police do it because the courts encourage it, excessive force. Think about this, you have three people in the room, locked in the room, just three of us. You're a police officer, and I'm the suspect, person that got arrested. I get beat up while I'm in that room. I get beat up so bad that both my eyes come out. Somebody was kicking me and kicking me and kicking me. Only the two of you were in the room, so I sue. Case gets dismissed because I cannot identify who kicked me.
Oh, no. So they both can't go to jail?
Again, we don't want one innocent person going to jail, do we? Do we? Do we? We want innocent people to go to prison or jail?
He was right. He wasn't innocent if he was right.
But how do we? But who's going to say they saw that?
He stood there. The other one, they did it. They stood there and they were in when he went in.
Again, summary judgment, where a judge says, based on the paperwork, we can determine whether or not your case should proceed or not. Yes, sir.
What about accessory to the crime?
What crime?
To the putting his eyes out.
Did you see who did it?
He didn't, but one knew it and the other.
So we don't get there.
And they each knew it.
We don't get there. What happens is, unless you can show a constitutional violation and say, if there's no question, right, if you say, well, somebody did it. Okay, well, somebody. That's not enough. You have to say, this officer did it. And within my article, I point to specific cases. Officers' names, towns, and the judges, they will dismiss cases. Because the reality is, this thing came up, the summary judgment, because imagine if every single person that wants to sue a municipality or city or a state or an individual officer had their day in court, the courts would be backed up.
So basically, you're saying that you get beat up, I'm supposed to look up and say, he punched me in the face, he kicked me in the back.
Exactly.
And I have to identify him.
You have to identify him.
And he probably took his
camera off. No care of him. Again, not political, but when you vote, yes, sir.
And there are laws about one witness as opposed to needing two. One witness can can't bring judgment against a person or persons. Is that correct or not?
Well, that becomes a credibility issue. So usually what a judge is going to look at, is there a question for a jury? If there's no question for a jury, like, then your case doesn't need to go to a jury. We don't need to have a trial. So the question is, did this officer use excessive force? Well, you don't even know which one used excessive force, so there's no question for a jury, so your case will get dismissed. If there's no constitutional violation and there's no question for a jury, then a judge can decide the case. That's what summary judgment is. So my question, oh, let me bring this back on. Was that excessive force?
Yes.
Was it?
Mm-hmm.
Yes. Depends by the law.
I'm sorry?
Depends by the law of the state.
Well, so again, a police officer is allowed to use force. They have to use an objectively reasonable amount of force to effectuate a lawful arrest. When you look at that, it's like, you know what? That doesn't look reasonable based on what was the gentleman doing? Yeah, so just because your feelings get hurt is not a reason to use force, right?
And if I use that force on somebody, I'm going to jail. Why don't that?
Right. So.
I'm sorry.
Yeah, no, don't be sorry.
I always like that when an officer wants to put handcuffs on you, they have to tell you why you're getting arrested.
No, they do not.
I always thought.
No, they absolutely do not.
And if the officer is not explaining why you're getting ready to put handcuffs on me, you know, I would see why the gentleman.
Right. So let's go back. So number one, a police officer does not need to tell you why you're being arrested. They don't need to tell you that. Because think about it, we call them like time life critical events, right? If I think you're a dangerous person, I'm not gonna say, excuse me, sir, just no. There's not time to do that. Certain places, depending on the situation, they may say, listen, you're under arrest because of this and that. Again, other states where you, especially in Jersey, you have no right to resist an unlawful arrest. Let me say it one more time. You have no right to resist an unlawful arrest. So I say, your name is Sharon, right? Sharon? No, your name's not Sharon. Your name is, but your name is Sharon, isn't it? No, say no.
Yeah.
Aren't you Sharon Brown? Yes, you are. We have an arrest warrant for you. Stand up, you're under arrest.
Oh, wow.
Stand up. Now, she say, no, I'm not Sharon, right? And you say no, and you stop and you push me away. Guess what she just did?
She resisted arrest.
She cannot do what? What did I just say? She can't do what? She can't resist an unlawful arrest in the state of New Jersey. Now, other states, we go out to Washington State, you comply. You comply. You know, you comply.
In my house, arrested me, and the woman they were looking for, they look left. I mean, she was light skinned, I'm dark skinned. She was tall. She's 5'11". I can't see 5'11" and 11 inches.
I'll get to that in a second. But again, you, depending on where you decide to live in the state of New Jersey, you do not have the right or the privilege to resist an unlawful arrest. Now, if you were in other states, right, you have the right to resist an unlawful arrest. You need to know the laws where you are. Yes, sir.
What about being Mirandized?
No. You don't need to be Mirandized. That's like only on television. Right. So Miranda. So there's a case that went up to United States Supreme Court, Miranda versus Arizona, which deals with when a person has the right to remain silent. So what most people think is that if you're under arrest, the police officers automatically have to read you your Miranda warnings. That you have the right to remain silent. Anything you say can be used against you in the court of law. If you can't afford to hire an attorney, won't be appointed to represent you. You can decide at any time to exercise your rights and not answer any questions. Well, guess what? That's not true. The only time a police officer has to read someone their Miranda warnings is when they have two things. And it's called custodial and interrogation. Custodial means that you're not free to go. You're under arrest. I said, do you need how many things in order for the police to be required to read you your Miranda warning? What were the two things I said? Custodial and interrogation. Interrogation means I'm asking you questions against your interest to make to have you implicate yourself in the crime. Where were you on Thursday? Where's the gun? Didn't you kill your wife? Now I'm asking you questions to incriminate you. So now you're not free to go, and I'm asking you incriminating questions. So now I'm required to read you your Miranda. But if I'm just saying you're under arrest, and I'm not asking you any questions, I don't have to read you Miranda warnings. And that's what happened. That's why, you know, it's nice that we're here, but we need younger people, we need other people here so that they need to be here. You know? They need to be here. Because a lot of people think that, you didn't read my Miranda rights. Guess what? That's what you see on television when they read Miranda all the time. But in New Jersey and again throughout the United States, an officer does not have to read anyone their Miranda warnings unless they have custodial, their own person under arrest, and they're interrogating the person. You have to have both. You have to have both. Yes. Okay. One second. Yes.
Just one question. You said under arrest or restraint. So
No. You have to have both. So you have to be under arrest, meaning not free to go, and they have to be asking you incriminating questions.
So if I'm being restrained, but you didn't arrest me, can you do one without the other?
Yeah, because you can detain a person
right.
without the person being under arrest.
So then,
and you don't have to read Miranda for that either. Okay.
So the clip that you showed,
yes, sir.
The one that the number has been pummeled by the police officer, what two of those cases were allowing the police officer to do that?
Again, the police officer acted objectively unreasonable. He used more force than was necessary to effectuate that arrest. But what about this officer here that didn't do any punching? Is he at fault?
Yes.
Why? He didn't punch the guy.
Yeah,
huh?
He held him.
But is he at fault for anything?
Yeah. He turned his back and he also should have challenged the officer to tell him that what was you think excessive force. He's got the responsibility and obligation to do that.
Yeah. Bystander liability. So the case I told you about, $12 million in Camden, we had four other officers there, and we call it bystander liability. You needed to stop those other officers, right? You needed to stop those other officers. You were culpable, and you're required to. And then again, it's like the, yes, right? Or you didn't stop him. You didn't stop him. Then I put, and I put two things here. Anybody know what this is?
Yeah.
What kind of snake? Anybody know?
A white snake.
Yeah. Anybody see this snake here? What is that? Anybody know what kind of snake that is? Huh? Yeah, they're both rattlesnakes. What's the difference between this snake and that snake?
One's white and one's dark.
Yeah, one's white and one's black. The police officers that used excessive force were what?
Black.
On what type of person?
Black.
And I tell people this all the time. Just because someone looks like you does not mean they have your best interest at heart, right? It doesn't, and let me give you something else. I have no idea whether or not race was a factor in it or not. I think you do everyone, it's a disservice. If those police officers were white and they're beating up this black guy, the first thing people are gonna say that race was a factor. It was because the guy was black. But what do we say when the police officer that's using excessive force is black? On a black person.
Their
I say that race, what do you say?
Their training failed them.
Or the culture, right? I know that if a police officer, the chief from Cranford is here, and I know if something like that were to happen, that there would be a talking to, and there would be discipline that took place, right? Because it continues. But here, it's a culture. Think about the culture in the city, the borough that you live in. That simply, and I say, would you rather die a slow, painful, black, poisonous snake death, or a slow, painful, white, poisonous snake death?
Yeah.
Which snake do you want to bite you and kill you? Which one? Which one? Would you rather get bitten by the black snake or the white snake? Neither, right? Because the end result is exactly the same. So we need to change the culture. You need to change the culture.
To clarify, you're not allowed to resist arrest.
An unlawful arrest, right?
An unlawful arrest. They don't have to tell you what they're arresting you for.
Correct.
And they don't have to Mirandize you unless they are holding you, unless you're in custody and they're asking you questions.
Asking you questions, yes. Can we role play for a second?
Sure.
Okay. So I'm going to pretend you're a student in my class. I'm going to see if you really understand what just happened, right? Mm-hmm. Okay. So now, you're in the room. Two Cranford police officers come in. They say, listen, after this meeting, we need to speak to you down at police headquarters. So you go down to police headquarters, 8 Springfield Avenue. They bring you into a back room, and they say, you're selling drugs, aren't you? We know you're selling drugs. Where are you getting the drugs from? Were they required to Mirandize you?
Yes.
Yes.
How many people say yes? Raise your hand.
Yes.
How many people say no?
No.
Why not?
She was free to leave,
right? So, and I said, you have to have what? You have to have both. You have to have both. So the question that you need to ask is what? Am I free to leave? But you came there on your own. You came there on your own. Yes.
I don't know about that.
you came there on your own.
Well, to be frank, it also depends upon the situation. Right?
You came down.
Two police officers in a room with a young woman, and maybe she doesn't have the expectation that she's allowed to leave.
Doesn't matter. It does not matter. If you're not sure, guess what you say? You went down there on your own.
That was quite intimidating.
Exactly. Exactly. Yeah. Yes.
So that YouTube, I've been on YouTube every once in a while and I watch it, where these in different states, it doesn't matter whether it's north or south, they're pulled over by a police officer, mm-hmm. and they just say, you know, can I have your license and registration? And the gentleman or the lady says, sorry, what did I do wrong first? And
yeah, that's a problem. That's a problem.
The officer still insists where's pay and
right,
the
right. So, the, so we're not gonna barter. If I pull you over, you're required to give me your license, your registration, insurance card.
Okay.
And you say, well, no, I want you to tell me why you pulled me over first. No. Give me your license, your registration, insurance card. You have no right to know. Now, depending on the situation, right, the officer may say, yeah, you know what? The reason I stopped you because you were going 45 in a 25-mile-an-hour zone. And they say, no, I wasn't. Yes, you were. No, you're going back and forth. I have no idea who you are. Right? So, again, inform to transform. Objectively reasonable. Yes?
I just want to make a comment because you said this is not about race because it's white snake or black snake, but I think that it's still about race because it is standard, I think, that black folks have been dehumanized, and even whether it's another black person who has a uniform on or there's a white person, they don't feel as though they're looking at another human being when they are doing something that is good.
I think
the black snake is more.
It would hurt me more to be. And I've been bitten by black snakes. a person that was black, right? I think that it hurts more when someone that you expect to protect you, to help you, that's like you, for them to. And that's why when we talk about NAACP, you know, a lot of people that helped during the civil rights movement were white people, right? So, but when you expect someone to do something, to have your back, and they come and they bite you, it hurts more, like I expected from that white snake, but not from you, right? You're right, but there's a thing where a person or individuals can discriminate against individuals without being prejudiced, and we call that internalized institutional racism. where you're trained to believe that these people are more likely to do certain things than others, and you're trained that way, regardless of black, white, whatever you are, and then you act that way, but there's no malice in your part. It's just that you've been conditioned to say black people are this, right? Black people, white people's ice is colder than black people's ice. If I'm gonna buy sugar, I'm gonna buy it from a white person because their sugar's sweeter, right? Because you were trained to this. You know, you were conditioned to that. Yes?
One more thing. Your scenario with the two officers that went to take the person down to the station, could at that point, when they said, we want to take you down to the station, the question at that point, before they even got in the control car, could they say, am I under arrest and am I free to go?
Yes.
You can do that?
Yep.
I just wanted to
know. Yep, absolutely. So, we're going to talk about that. Yes?
What about if you're inside your house? Could they actually
go inside your house and bring you out?
Yeah.
Under certain circumstances.
Without the warrant and
Majority under certain circumstances. Yeah. But the majority of time the answer is no. But under certain circumstances, they may be able to go inside your home without a warrant. So I want to talk about this thing again, qualified immunity, something that's objectively reasonable or not. Watch this slide. You be the officer. So simply because you can't see someone's hands, you're going to shoot him?
No, either shoot him or shoot me.
What?
Shoot him or
shoot him. Is he a threat?
No.
Well, he's coming out on a train.
Oh, I'm sorry. I'm sorry. Yeah, I'm sorry.
Hold on one second.
Yes, he's a threat because he's going at the officer with a gun on him.
Who's got a gun on him?
The officer. Isn't
that an officer has a gun on him, yes.
So why would you come at a person with a gun on him?
I just want to make sure, I want to make sure I understand what you're saying. You're saying that this gentleman here is a threat because he also has a gun.
Yes. Yeah, because who in their right mind would come out and offer a gun?
So you get shot for not being in your right mind?
I don't know what you have.
You don't know?
No. Okay. And I'm fearing for my life.
You're fearing for your life?
He's going to live here for his life.
Based on what? So the person comes up to you, so somebody comes up to police officer, they should be, we expect them to shoot.
Don't know what they have.
Because you don't know what they have, we expect them to shoot. Yes.
If the officer would say, come here, or something like that, he might say, we don't know. You don't know if it's a stop, freeze, or the officer would say, come here, towards them. I mean, we have doubt. But,
you would shoot this guy?
He's supposed to.
I'm asking, you going to shoot him?
I don't know,
you got to decide. 5, 4, 3, 2. I'm sorry. You're going to shoot? How many people are going to shoot?
Are you going to say something?
I don't know.
What are you going to say?
First of all, we don't know what happened before.
One second.
Go ahead. It's unfair for you to ask us this question considering we don't know what's transpired beforehand.
Okay, so you're saying it's, can you hear?
No.
Okay, one more time.
I said it's unfair for you to ask us that question because we don't know what transpired before that.
Okay, so let me tell you, this is what happened before that. Police get a call of a suspicious person in the playground. Police officer says, hey, come here, and the guy's coming. Does that make a difference?
Yeah.
We gonna shoot him now?
No.
What about this? Police get a call, there's a guy in the playground with a gun. No, it's coming to
What kind of shooting are you doing?
Are you going to shoot him in the foot to stand down?
Right, so now let's think about it. In the state of New Jersey, usually pretty much across the United States, police officers are not shooting a person in the leg. Police officers are aimed to shoot center mass because that's the largest area. And that's where they're trained to shoot. So they're not going to shoot the person in the leg so they stop. So, you got to make a decision. Are we going to shoot the person or are we not going to shoot them?
No.
Shoot the second.
Shoot center mass. But you can only shoot if it's objectively, so now, the person who said they were going to shoot, okay, so you're going to shoot him, right? So now let's listen. You now shot him, and you find out he had no gun. Was it reasonable for you to believe he had a gun?
Well, I'm just saying that hip shot my heel.
So let me ask you this. Was it reasonable for you to shoot the person? Were you truly in fear for your life?
Yes.
Should you have qualified immunity? Should you be sued personally because you made a mistake?
Not in that part. It's not in that part. The issue is, the objectively is for me to decide. You can never decide that.
Yes, there's a standard for what's objective, but I'll get to that in a little bit. What were you going to say?
I was going to say, under the second scenario, when they've been told that there's someone in the playground with a gun and the person is coming at them, is different than...
Who told them? Just because somebody called? Yeah, but just because somebody calls up and says, hey, my neighbor's selling drugs, should the police go over there? Right? It has to be, so it has to be objectively reasonable. So, but again, I say, police do not have to be 100% right. How many people are perfect in this room other than my wife in the back? Right? If the average person is 99.99% accurate, that means two airplanes landing at Newark Airport each day would be unsafe. That's at 99.99%. It's okay if you're not on one of those two airplanes that are landing at Newark Airport. If Overlook Hospital has a rate of, if they're 99.99% accurate, 18 babies will go home with the wrong parents each day. I'm not sure if my son is mine or not. I think he may have been one of those guys. But imagine that. Imagine that. 99.99% correct. 18 babies are going home with the wrong people. In 2023, the surgeon is 99.99% accurate. 567 pacemaker operations will be performed incorrectly. We want all of them to be correct, right? But they're 99.99% accurate. They're still going to have 567 pacemaker operations that are going to be performed inaccurate. ...22,792 pieces of mail will be mishandled within the next 12 hours. We want police officers to act reasonably. They cannot be 100% correct, just like here. Right? They can't be 100% correct. So there's this thing we call arguable probable cause and probable cause. We'll talk about that during our next meeting. But again, is this reasonable? This is Texas. This guy's under arrest. They tie him up. Can't put him on the horse. Is there anything else you can do? Let's see. What else can we do? I'm sorry. You had a question with?
Is that a gun?
Does
he have a gun?
No, it's a rope.
It's a rope that's tethered
to his handcuffs, and he's walking, right? And I think it gets to your point when you're saying, you know, do you think that race has a factor here? We're taking this black guy, he's handcuffed, we're tying him, and we're going to walk him through the streets.
Oh, no, I didn't see that.
It's not the police officer's job to punish anybody. It's their job to arrest people.
Would it have been excessive if they had the rope around his neck and walking like that? This is Texas, but
let me ask you this. Is this a violation of this gentleman's, any of his constitutional rights? Which one?
No.
What constitutional rights is that you can't be walked down the street while handcuffed?
That's right.
Cruel and unusual punishment.
That's not punishment. That's, you're walking.
Like a dog?
Again, his feelings are hurt. It doesn't look right, but guess what? There's nothing illegal about that. Now, maybe the chief of that department's going to have a problem and the officer can be disciplined, but a suit, a federal suit or a state suit, those officers did nothing wrong. They may have violated their agency policy, but they didn't do anything wrong. It doesn't look right, right? Is it generally known that you should not handcuff a person and have them walk down the street and when you're on a horse? Is that universally known in law enforcement? The answer is no, right? It's up to the police chief in that municipality to say this is totally unacceptable and to discipline that officer. someone, I'm not going to say who, I know she's like, wait a second, is that you? Look at this. I see this all the time. You see these two police officers, and they have two young kids on the ground. Anybody who drive by see that? See something like that? Huh?
Yeah.
On the curb, sitting on the ground. It's kind of humiliating. How do you say the word? Demeaning. Right? And then here, again, these are two Cranford police officers. Right? Have a gentleman outside the car. This was just a couple days ago. Outside the car. Why do you need two police officers? Right? Why do you need three or four police officers? Right? It's an overkill, right?
No.
No? Yes? No?
Yes.
You think so? Yeah. Again, everyone's entitled to their opinions. This is one that touched my heart. This is old. I think this is in Texas. I tell people the most dangerous places in the country to be a police officer are small municipalities. Cranford, Roselle Park, even more dangerous in Winfield. Right? Because you, guess what? Because it's service. You want to give the citizens service, and you're not in Newark, and you're not in Camden, you're not in Atlantic City, where you're every time you come up to someone, you think you're going to get killed. It's in the back of your mind, but you know what? It's service. What would I tell you? This, again, I'm baiting you. This white female police officer is investigating this black male with his beautiful 12-year-old brown-skinned daughter. And what if this police officer makes this guy lay down on the ground in front of his daughter as she conducts her investigation? Would that be appropriate? Or would that be offensive? You're driving down the street, you see a police officer, doesn't matter, black, white, dealing with a gentleman, an African-American male, black male, and have him lying down on the ground, and his little 12-year-old son or 7-year-old daughter is there. Is that appropriate?
No.
Why not?
Damn, I'll go cruel and unusual.
Okay. Well, let's just talk about cruel and unusual. Everyone will transition, right? Everyone will die eventually, right? So that's not unusual to die, right? It's not unusual for people to die, right?
Right.
Okay, so, I mean, like, we don't want to die now, right? Who could take, right? We don't want to die like right now, but it's not unusual to die.
Right.
Maybe the method in which the person dies. So it's not unusual. Is it unusual to have someone sit on the ground?
You didn't say sitting, but you know, right.
All right, lying on the ground.
That is unusual, yeah, and cruel. Okay. And you just mentioned his daughter.
Because in front of his daughter, right? Disrespectful. Yeah. Again, everyone's entitled to their opinion, but again, you have to be in the perspective of a police officer. Again, depending on the, this is a female police officer, depending on the situation, when you're driving down the street and you see 5, 6, 7 police cars with one person there, think about it. Maybe it's an overkill. Maybe it's not. Maybe there's a reason.
She starts running radar on Business Loop 59 and clocks a blue Windstar van for speeding. Department policy dictates she call out on every stop.
Gave her a tag number. Once I got him out of the vehicle, got his driver's license, I gave her all of his descriptors, ran a check on him. I ran his driver's license check for wanted, and a criminal history check. He comes back wanted for traffic warrants from DPS, Texas Department of Public Safety, traffic warrants.
Officer Jeter notes the little girl on the passenger side of the driver's seat come out of the car, but she does not call for backup.
See, I know the other officer that generally works together, he was on a traffic stop at the same time that I was. We worked real close together, and if he was on some, stop, I would go with him. If I was on stop, vice versa, he'd go with me. But I know he was on a traffic stop at the same time. He was probably maybe 3/4 mile up the road from me.
Have you ever come to the phone?
Yeah.
I was asking, I just would have.
Did she possibly think the little girl was a safety valve, neutralizing the likelihood of violence?
It is possible. I don't know, like I said, what my feelings were that day, but it's possible that she would think, well, maybe don't do something for the child, scar the child for life, or that the father wouldn't do anything. It's always a possibility.
Do you have any objection to following your video? No, I don't. Is that a problem? don't mind just sending them back. If you want to dollar send back with you, it's okay. Or she can sit in the van, it'll be the one.
But when you look back at that now and you see yourself in that position with him back there and you bending into the car, is there something that you would do different today?
One thing is he had been pretty easygoing. Of course, I didn't see the thing that happened when I had my head stuck in the vehicle. You know, the fact he was trying to get his daughter away, get her to stand off the road, because he already had planned. He knew I was going to find that note. I wouldn't recommend for anybody to search a vehicle without backup. Don't stick your head in the vehicle where you can't see what that person or persons are doing, because you know what's going to happen. You can't see significant things like even motions they may make someone else that they've been planning something. Just even, you know, just things are really significant. Not necessarily that they're going to jump on you while you have your head stuck in the vehicle because you think you can watch them. Don't put yourself in a predicament. Life's too precious.
In retrospect, high on Officer Jeter's wish list too was not only her positioning, but also the position of the subject, Jorge Orozco. After Officer Jeter found the dope, Orozco began a verbal dance.
And duck or dodge or pull, you know, there's not enough time. Because just because that fist comes back, you know, you may see it, and I don't remember if I saw it or not, I'm sure that I did, but there's not enough time to react in the close proximity. Within arm's reach, you don't have enough time.
It was obvious Orozco wanted to kill Officer Jeter. He even tried to wrest her service weapon, a Glock 9mm, from her Safariland Level 2 holster. Her life was probably spared because an angel in human form chose to stop.
Once the first guy stopped, he's from Houston, school teacher from Houston, and I've had contact with him since.
I think it's always great to have two, three, four police officers on the stop. Even though it may not look good to have multiple officers there, it's good for my protection and it's good for your protection, right? For this person, for this female officer, female, doesn't matter, for a police officer to be engaging with someone by themselves, it's not safe for them. It's not safe for them. And they may think twice before they do something.
And more people know martial arts now.
Yes.
You know, my thing is that I know police. I've never been a police officer. I don't have any family of police officer, but I could just imagine that police officers are always on high alert because they deal with violence or non-violence, and you never know.
I tell everyone across the country, there's no such thing as a low threat situation. Mm-hmm. Every encounter a police officer has. Either threat or hiker. Yes.
Why did she stop him in the first place?
Was he speeding?
He was speeding. And he had a warrant for
his arrest. Did she know that?
Well, even like nowadays, the police will probably, if you're driving your car and you have a warrant, they'll probably know before they even stop you from your license.
Pull him over and wait.
Let him go?
No, not have him. Wait.
There's only one other police officer in this town.
Oh.
It's a small town. Think about this for a second, then I have two more things I think I just want to talk about.
Just in the same way as you don't focus your attention on how you make your thyroid gland function, so in the same way you don't have any attention focused on how you shine the sun. So then,
what? No, that's what? He is not a run.
Because in order to understand what the self is, you have to remember that it doesn't need to remember anything. Just like you don't need to know how you work your thyroid gland. So then, when you die, you're not going to have to put up with everlasting non-existence, because that's not an experience. A lot of people are afraid. If they die, they're going to be locked up in a dark room forever. And sort of undergo that.
So police proceed now on the way on surface streets in...
One of the most interesting things in the world, this is a yoga, this is a way of realization. Try and imagine what it will be like to go to sleep and never wake up. Think about that. Children think about it. It's one of the great wonders of life. What will it be like to go to sleep and never wake up? And if you think long enough about that, something will happen to you. You will find out, among other things, that it will pose a next question to you. What was it like to wake up after having never gone to sleep? That was when you were born. You see, you can't have an experience of nothing. Nature abhors a vacuum. So after you're dead, the only thing that can happen is the same experience, or the same sort of experience, as when you were born. In other words, we all know very well that after people die, other people are born. And they're all you. Only you can only experience it one at a time. Everybody is I. You all know you're you. And wheresoever beings exist throughout all galaxies, it doesn't make any difference. You are all of them. And when they come to being, that's you. You know that very well. Only you don't have to remember the past. In the same way, you don't have to think about how you were with the thyroid gland. Or whatever else it is.
All of you put your fucking hands up.
You don't have to know how to shine the sun. You just do it.
Just ask for some prayer. Richard here, so you would accept it up. Hands up! Hands up!
Isn't it really astonishing
that you
are? I'll
shoot you! Hands up!
And if you're doing all of this and you don't have any education,
I'll shoot you
again!
Hands up!
Never done? The truth is miracle? Well, we're finding that from a strictly scientific standpoint, this organism is a continuous energy with everything else that's going on. And if I am my foot, I am the sun.
So a police officer, when we assess, when you assess a police officer, anything they do,
the standard is objectively reasonable. So the first, maybe the second slide they show you when the guy was coming with his hand behind his back, the question was it objectively reasonable for the officer, for you to reasonably believe that your life is in danger? And this comes from the United States Supreme Court case, which is Graham versus Connor. And in this Graham versus Connor case, Graham was a diabetic. And he was going into, you know, he didn't have enough sugar in his system. He's with his friend in a car. He's like, I think I'm going to pass out. I need to get some sugar. So he goes into a convenience store, and he's going to buy some orange juice or some soda. But the line is too long for him to pay. So he runs out of the store, gets into the car, and the car's gone, and his friend's taking him someplace else to find some sugar. There's been a rash of burglaries of convenience stores in the area. The cops are looking at these convenience stores. They see Graham go into the store, then they see him run out, get into a car, and then take off. What do you think the cops are thinking? That they what? Is it reasonable for them to think that? Is it objectively reasonable for them to think that the store got robbed?
Yes.
No.
Yes.
Yes.
Ah, you see, that's why I have a job. That's why they hire me, right? You say no?
No.
Why not?
Are you going to kill
the
person because...
No. We're not killing. We're saying we're going to stop them. Is it objectively reasonable to stop them? Let me do this one first. Make it a little bit easier. Let me give you this story. Cherry pie. Right? Aunt Mabel made a cherry pie. She put it on a windowsill to let it cool. She goes, she lays down, she comes back. Somebody stole her cherry pie. Somebody stole her cherry pie. Police officers walking down the street, they see this guy with cherries on his face eating a cherry pie. Is it reasonable for them to believe that that guy stole the cherry pie?
No.
Yes.
But let's say he just has cherries all on him, and he's walking down the street with cherries on him. It's not enough to arrest him, but do you think it's enough for the police officer to go up to the person and talk to him and say, hey, where'd you get that cherry pie?
Is he free to leave?
No, he's not free to leave. You're not free to leave because I'm investigating a crime. You are not free to go.
So then you have to bring him my right.
Nope, I didn't ask you anything yet.
Well, I want to speak to a lawyer.
Okay, then fine. Then I can detain you until my suspicion is either dissolved or not. But it's enough to stop that person. Right? So if we go back to Graham, the police officer stopped Graham. They get him out of the car. He runs around a circle in the car. The police officer's handcuffed, don't know what's going on. They slam him to the back of the car to handcuff him. He says he gets hurt, and he files a federal lawsuit. It goes all the way up to the United States Supreme Court saying that I didn't rob the store. Police shouldn't have stopped me. The question is not whether or not the person robbed the store or not. The question is, was it reasonable for the officer to believe that the person robbed the store? And if it was reasonable for the person, for them to investigate it, to say, I see this guy running out, it has to be objectively reasonable. You know, I usually do like a drill in my class. And I say, you know, like I carry a gun, I have it on my leg, and what I'm gonna do, there's no bullets or anything in it. I'm gonna bend down. I took the bullets out, don't worry about it. Right? I'm gonna bend down, I'm gonna bring the gun up, I'm gonna point it, and when at the point when you feel that your life is in danger, you hit your hand, you clap your hands. It means that you're shooting me back, right?
Okay.
Right, you ready? So I'm gonna go down and come up with the gun. There's no bullets in it. Okay. When you feel that your life is in danger, you clap your hands. You ready?
Okay.
What the hell are you doing?
How's it?
What? So you shot me because you're scared?
You went too quick.
Because I was quick. So the question is, was it objectively reasonable for her to think that I had a gun? Did I have a gun? No. So you shot an unarmed person. Right? So again, it's nice. First 2 minutes talk about police officers. Let me tell you something. There are so many cases where race is a factor, where the police officer did something they absolutely should not have done. There are times when they acted wrong, but it was reasonable. Right? You ever take a test, multiple choice test, and you get the answer right, but for the wrong reason, because you just guessed? Right? So the only thing that I say is that, again, look at the situation and try to determine, okay, did the person have cherries on their face? Was it reasonable, or was it, guess what? It was a black person, it was a Hispanic person, a person in a socioeconomically depressed area, and I was afraid of them, so that's why I shot them, because their life has no value. That happens. But that's not always the case. You know? That's not always the case. And that's my cherry pie. I'm not going to talk about New Mirage. What I would like, you know, if anybody has any questions, I think maybe we can talk. But I think right next door, there's coffee, there's some water, there's some cookies. You know, maybe just come by for maybe a couple minutes, you know, meet someone, talk to someone, maybe someone that you've never seen, and I think that's a lot of the problem. A lot of problems that we don't talk to one another. And I know the chief does a citizen police academy, a lot of towns do citizen police academies, and I always say, the only people that go to those academies are people that like the police, right? We need people that don't like the police. We need people that have, you know, that have questions, that think things are going wrong. We need to bring those people into the room and have conversations with them. Yes?
So, back in the day, they used to have the DARE program.
Mm-hmm.
And I know even, you know, in organizations I've been in the past.
DARE got sued because the study she started out was in Texas. DARE got sued. They were saying that DARE was introducing kids to drugs where they would not have done. So that's one of the reasons they don't have it. DARE got sued years ago. But there's other programs.
So, and my basis to my question was, is there anything that starts at the middle school level or the early high school level that says, you know, these are the things that you should not do if you're ever stopped, or if you're with your friends, or you encounter a police officer.
So
kids, you know, kids kind of better understand, because we're adults. Police.
Generally, it's yes, and it depends on the municipality and the city. But also, there's legislation that was passed in the state of New Jersey, I believe it was 5-6 years ago, that it's required a certain, interaction with law enforcement that's supposed to take place within the schools, just like the Amistad, supposed to be taught in schools, but things are always not. Yes.
I just want to say this is great, Dr. Chapman, and to my fellow NAACP team members. It was really good discussion. A lot of knowledge was learned today. But give that a round of applause, because it really was. I have family members that are police officers. I work with police every day in my capacity. And still some of these things I did not know. And I think a lot of times they go into the schools, they're trying to deter children from doing crime, but no one teaches about how to interact and how to understand that, look, don't create that reasonable fear, because then, I mean, moms do it, we tell our kids, just, if the police stop you, answer the questions, whatever, but there's so much misinformation about what you can and cannot do, what your rights are. How do we survive that? Because I think it's the misinformation maybe that leads to situations that could be deadly.
Thank you. The Union County Prosecutor's Office does have a program called Police and Teams Together. And if the municipality requests it, they'll go into any community in Union County, and they spend like a half day with students going over various issues, learning how to address the police and to familiarize themselves with the police and procedures in the community.
I don't know if it's even possible, but how do you train police officers if they have bias and prejudice and racism and all? I guess that's an impossible question.
I think we all have biases. Right, a bias, and I don't think there's anything wrong with being biased or being racist, but just don't do it to somebody, right? Like, I don't have to like you, you don't have to like me, but don't affect my life because you don't like me. But there's a lot of people I don't like.
Like, was that person, the ones in Texas, yeah, was some of these incidences created because the officer stopped somebody who was a person of color, and then it escalates? Like, how do you even train on that? I don't know.
And how do you prove it?
The thing is, when I was a child, my parents always said that, just like teachers and officers, you respect them. But this new generation has a different outlook on police officers. And I think that's a shame. Although there is good and bad in every religion, color, and there probably are some bad apple police officers. But I think our children need to know that if a police officer asks them or stops them for whatever reason, that they should comply with the officer. I think not listening or doing what the officer says kind of gets the officers, I don't know what you call it,
heightened awareness.
And then if there's a fast reaction, I feel for the police officers, but I feel for the children that probably have dealt with police officers when they were young, because maybe they have family members that police officers used to come in, break the doors or whatever it is. So they already have that in themselves, that they're trying to avoid the police officer and trying to not listen to the police officer because they've had that negativity all their life. And I think we need to teach our children to obey the officer as long as they're not
No?
I want to have, can we have this conversation next door?
Yeah, can we go over there?
Yeah. But my thing is, you know what? I don't want my, I want my kid to be treated like any other kid.